Today in the morning session, we are going to cover a lot of ground, most of it introductory. So some of these things will be clarified during the lab sessions and subsequent days. I'll briefly talk about information systems, something that all of you know. So I'll just reiterate a few important points, particularly about the use of conventional programming languages such as COBOL and what kind of problems we face. We'll then introduce the entity relationship model, which is a very important model in representing information system requirements. We ordinarily use object-oriented models these days, which we shall cover in our next course. But this is a very fundamental model. And of course, there's a one-on-one mapping between the ER model and the object model. We'll then look at the relational model. This is different from the entity relationship model, where the relationship is used more in terms of association. The relational model comes out of relational algebra, foundations for which were laid by Professor Codd in 1972, and that is the basis of the entire relational database management system as we see today. Earlier, some of you might have heard of network databases, hierarchical databases. Those were databases where navigating through various contents of the database was the main concern. A relational model for the first time said, don't bother about navigation, bother about modeling your information structures appropriately. And Professor Codd provided very strong mathematical foundations for this. There are two important foundations. One is called the relational algebra, which we'll look at briefly. The other is called relational calculus, which we're not going to touch. We will then have an introduction to the database management system itself, and very specifically we shall look at the data definition, the DDL or data definition language of SQL, the structured query language, which is the lingua franca of DBMS, provides for defining data. We shall see what kind of data types are there. We shall also see what is meant by integrity constraints and how do you define them, and we'll see a few advanced data types, particularly like date and time, which are not handled satisfactorily in conventional programming languages like COBOL at all. So in this first session, we'll talk about information systems. We'll quickly look at the steps in building an information system. Again, as I said, this is a bit of a reiteration because all of you are familiar with this. We'll take as an example an academic information system. Assume all of you are students with roll numbers and you are registering for courses in a semester. What kind of information do you need and how the course lists are managed, typically through an example of COBOL program. And then we shall see the implications of using COBOL and the disadvantages of using COBOL, through which we will go to the information modeling and then discuss the entity relationship model. It will be part of the session. This is common knowledge. In any information system, you have to worry about the information structures and procedures. What are the workflow and steps in an activity which need to be captured by your algorithms? What information needs to be processed? What is the processing logic? What is the role of people in that information system? So these are the information structures and procedures part. But that's not alone. In any information system, you have to take cognizance of the available technology, tools, and products. Traditionally, the information technology used to be the part of books, pencils, typewriters, telephones. None of us, by the way, look at these technology elements as information technology elements. I mean, if you want to buy a fountain pen and go to a shopkeeper, you don't ask for information technology section, you ask for a pen. The reason is that particular technology has become so ubiquitous in our lives. Right from our childhood, we adopt that. The digital technology like computers, operating systems, databases, modem, routers, etc. are relatively a new phenomenon in humanity. They have not been yet absorbed. You will notice that our children are far better exposed to that technology than we were, and their children, your grandchildren or great-grandchildren, someday will treat this modern information technology as so ubiquitous that you will not talk about this as IT, but you will talk about as database programs or whatever, different kind. The last but not the least important component of information system is people, comprised of the operational staff, supervisors and managers from the organization side, and external users who are customers or other external entities. The behavior of the people, the activities that they have to undertake, the ease with which they can undertake these activities are crucial aspects of designing any information system. Normally, each activity in the real world has an associated information system, whether we realize it or not. For example, you are attending this course, you actually have, without knowing it perhaps, built an information system around it. So you are taking down some notes on a notebook, you will prepare a set of notes at the end, you will be able to refer to them, you know that you have to attend a lab. So all these activities, you are building an information system uncannily. Modern information systems for businesses, of course, have to be built explicitly by design. Some examples of academic systems which we shall see about enrollment and course registration, but you take any one of these activities, you will require an information system for each one. When you conglomerate all of these, you talk about a corporate information system or enterprise-wide information system. So like your FEEP is a front-end system, but you know that associated with it is an operational data store at the back end, where the data comes from all the branches and resides there, which can be used to trigger activities on your web portal, which can be used to feed data into a data warehouse, which Seema has been building for quite some time. There are n number of other applications which could be related to human resource management, which could be related to a variety of other things, and all of these would then comprise an enterprise system for LIs. These systems are typically broken into three classifications: OLTP, or online transaction processing systems, which is going to be the meat of our discussion in our database course; management information system, which is essentially reporting systems for both tactical and strategic reasons; and decision support system. So a data warehouse is like a decision support system, the FEP is like a transactional system, and any reporting system that you have coming out of either ODS or coming out of your branch servers within the branch for reporting purposes would be an MIS system. All of them, of course, look at the same basic data that gets into the transactions. And that is why transactional systems are most crucial. The transactional systems need not be online, as the term OLTP defines. They could be even batch, as used to happen once upon a time. But today, with modern computing technology, you have online transaction processing systems. Reservation for a train journey, for example, which requires activities such as filling up of an application form, scrutiny of the form, checking the availability, payment of fare, payment of reservation charges, and issue of tickets. All of these together will comprise a transaction processing system. You could do a reservation through internet today, wherein you start to finish activity on internet, where you actually pay through your credit card and take a ticket printout at your own home. All together will comprise a transaction. Let me briefly describe the purpose of forms, which are so important, and a lot of transformation of information is required vis-a-vis the forms versus whatever and however you store things inside your computer. A form such as railway reservation form will have elemental information like train number, destination, class, date, whatever. The form ensures that there is a systematic gathering of mandatory data. There is a quick visual validation and verification possible, because we are all used to written information. There is an ease of ordered storage in a file or a folder, so that the train number comes first, followed by destination, followed by class, not in any haphazard manner for different people. The form has that ability. And last but not the least, legality of the process is ensured when a form is signed. Why I describe these properties is that for quite some time in our lives, we are not going to be able to get rid of paper forms. And it is our responsibility to ensure that A, the information is collected properly in the forms, in which case designing of the form is also part of the information design process for people. And B, the information on the form is correctly captured, validated, and verified before you proceed further. They are very important steps. I mentioned reservation as an OLTP system. Let me introduce some terms which we will meet again in the course. A transaction is expected to have what is known as acid properties. Acid stands for these four important words: atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. Right now, let me just briefly describe atomicity. If a transaction has multiple steps, then you say that when you execute a transaction, either all those steps are completely conducted satisfactorily or nothing is conducted at all. That means, even if there are five steps, all five together form an atomic transaction. To again quote the example of railway reservation system, suppose you are doing reservation on internet and you go to that site and your money is debited from your credit card. But when the credit card payment gateway throws you back to the railway server asks you, who are you? So that means money has gone, but the ticket has not come. Would you like that situation? No. On the other hand, imagine that the railway first gives you ticket and then sends you the payment gateway and you quietly walk off from the computer. The railways will not like it. Or suppose you pay the money, the railway reservation server gets to know that the money has been paid, but the connection breaks. There are so many things that can happen. In any eventuality, what you and I would like and what railways would like, the following should happen. Even after 2 days, 5 days, 10 days, the situation must be either you have paid money and got a ticket, or I have not taken money from you and I have not given you. So paying money and giving ticket must happen as an atomic activity. Ensuring that is an extremely important requirement in information systems. Many of you who have struggled with COBOL programs to ensure that, particularly in the light of possible breakdowns in the operating system or disk failures, etc., etc., would realize the importance. Thankfully, database management systems today provide for such automatic guarantee of atomicity. There are other characteristics such as consistency, isolation, durability, and so on. We shall see these terms in the later part of the course. The key expectations from any online transaction processing system is the response time for users and throughput for the service provider. In a railway reservation system, whether it takes 25 seconds to get your ticket or whether it takes 2 hours on an internet is important from you. But for the railway system, whether it is capable of delivering 10,000 tickets a day or whether it is capable of delivering only 1,000 tickets a day is an important concern. That part is called throughput for the system, and this part is called the response time of this. Both are important. Both need not be at loggerheads. However, often if you tune a parameter to increase your throughput, you might chew up the response time to individuals. Our endeavor, therefore, as information system designers, is always to ensure that we get the minimum possible response time and we get the maximum possible throughput. On the last day, when we discuss the performance related issues, we shall see how these two parameters are extremely important. In fact, I recall fondly the exercise that we had done for LIC's benchmark on data warehouse, where these were the two parameters that we considered the most important. For the passenger, it is the total lead time and convenience. For the railway authorities, it is reduced internal workflow, greater organizational work efficiency. And these are like common sense things. Significant reduction in cost of operation is expected. If you go to book a ticket to a railway station versus you book on internet, you can see how much cost reduction it is for you, time reduction for you. Okay. Similarly, for railways, they simply get rid of one clerk who has to be posted to serve you. And the clerk cannot be posted 24 hours. So there is a cost reduction on both sides. That's the greatest advantage of the modern IT. All of you know that. These are the main considerations while planning for an information system. These things are rarely stated as I am stating them, and that's why I was tempted to repeat them. With apologies to the ladies, this is called five wives and a husband. That's how people remember it. So these are the questions that each one of us must ask and must get explicit answer before you even think of doing any program design or program. In fact, half the problems in information systems which arise subsequently in the operations are because somebody failed to ask these questions and get proper answers at the beginning. The first question: what or which information is needed? So what are the sources of that information? How are you going to store that information? how it is going to be processed, who needs it, which users, which staff, which customers, which people, when is it needed, is it high priority, is it urgent, it is routine, is just for information, where is the information needed, location. If the information is needed in Coimbatore branch and you say it is sitting on my server in Mumbai, is not good enough. If you say that I have a temporary disconnect on the network and therefore my customer in Coimbatore can merrily come back tomorrow, where so far he did because you were the only ones offering life insurance. Now he won't. He will go to somebody else who has a better connectivity. Or somebody else who, in spite of dropping connectivity, serves the customer's need. So where is the information required is absolutely important. We normally talk of static location, but now you know that the location could be mobile. Why is information required? What is the purpose? What are the actions by anybody, your customers, yourselves, depend on that information, whether it is for decision making, whether it is FII means for your information, whether it is for archiving, what is the purpose? Very important. After you ask what, who, when, where and why, incidentally these questions what, who, when, where and why are important not only in designing information systems, but they are generally important in life. Any activity that we do, if we are careful in asking these questions to ourselves, our planning and execution would become that much more efficient generally. That's my belief. But we are talking in the context of information system now. Lastly, we come to the question of how. That is the edge. How is it to be provided? What are the resources? What are the plan? What is the execution? With relate to how, there are some additional considerations. First of all, you may have to ask all the W questions again. For example, for information system, where is this information available? Who will provide it? When it will be provided? Okay, where it will be captured? So all these five W's will have to be asked again for how. For each of the hows, you will have to ask and get those answers, and those answers have to be written down. Apart from all these, you need to worry about the ease and convenience of the use of the operations of the system. And the ease and convenience is to be from the perspective of the end users of the system. Invariably, it has been seen that programmers design and implement those features which they find most easy and most convenient to implement. The purpose of an information system is to serve end users, whether your own colleagues in your organization or customers. And it's from their perspective that you must determine the ease and convenience. Cost and time required to design, implement, operate and modify the information system. Obviously, it's a commercial activity, so we have to worry about how much money we need to spend or how much time we need to spend. There is no point in building an information system which will take about 20 years when it is needed next year. Or there is no point in building an information system to support a small and medium sector enterprise business whose annual turnover is rupees 50 lakh, where the cost of the information system is 5 crores. So these are naturally important considerations. Information security is an important aspect. It is particularly important in the modern networked world. Access rights, security classification. You are familiar with security classification, right? This is a sort of military term, general, that means anybody can access. Restricted. That means only few people. Confidential, that means it is only by name. Secret, that means nobody including the originator should know about it. Okay. And finally, monitoring and control for the sake of ensuring efficiency. So you need to capture activity logs, you need to have performance measures. You have 20 railway reservation clerks. Two reservation clerks are particularly slow. They cause problems to the customers. How will you find that out? So if you have activity logs at the end of the day and over many days, you can capture that and you can quietly call those two people and tell them to improve or transfer them somewhere, take some action. Similarly, you find some people who are extremely fast. You can again quietly call them out and ask them the secret of their success. What is it that they do? Can they teach their colleagues to do something else? That's how you spread efficiency in an organization. So information systems play a vital role through the activity logs, performance measures, etc., which are collected over time. These are the standard phases in developing any information system. Conceptualization and planning is an absolutely important activity to begin with, where you ask all those W's and H and all those questions. Analysis and design is a formal activity where you actually design the software to be built, the application software. Development is the job of coding and testing. Unfortunately, since most of us has, as programmers spend maximum time in coding and testing, we tend to believe that that forms the most important part of information system. Sadly, it does not. It forms the most important part of our daily schedule, but it corresponds to only about 10 to 15% of the importance in the weightage on the entire information system. Keep that in mind. The world is not fair. 80% of Godagiri work that we do counts for only 20% of life's import. But that's part of life. But so that we should not lose sight of the important parts, it is necessary for us to remember that conceptualization and planning and a good analysis and design is absolutely mandatory before you start building or developing a system. And after you develop, the implementation and operations, again, all of you are familiar with that. So some of you would have spent sleepless nights in branches wondering why the hell this file is not opening or that operating system is crashed or whatever, whatever. And then finally, for that information system to review, to modify and to update. Life of an information system, which is a computerized information system, is typically 10 to 15 years. So you might build it in anywhere between 1 to 3 years. And while those people who build it think that that's the maximum amount of work that has been done. But the maintenance of that, which is not just routine maintenance like you maintain buildings, because buildings don't change their shape after they're built. But software changes its contents significantly because the business requirements change. So the maintenance phase over the next 10 years constitutes at least 3 to 4 times the cost of the original development itself. And that phase is therefore equally important. In fact, technically there is no distinction between the original development and maintenance because new features keep coming. Unfortunately, the mindset of the people, because the terminology has become very cockeyed, you know, I am developing, okay, oh, he is only testing, or he is developing, I am only maintaining. This is stupid. Development, testing, maintenance is a continuous spectrum. There is absolutely no distinction between these, absolutely no distinction, particularly the testing. Large number of problems come because inadequate testing. Finally, review of the application, review of the code, etc. In this, we will just jump now to the development phase, the coding phase, because we want to now ultimately look at database management system from a programmer's perspective. So, we'll look at a COBOL programming example and see what are the problems that we face. So here is an example. Imagine all of you are students, you have been enrolled in this university, in IIT, so you have a roll number, and there are courses which are offered. At each semester, you have to register for the courses. Some may be compulsory courses, some may be optional. Each course has a course code, and you can register for any number of courses, but on an average, we know that in IIT, on an average, about 6 courses are registered to by every student. Some may register for 12, where 5 may be labs or something, some may register for 3, whatever. Now, you are given the course registration form for about 4,500. I'm sorry, there is a syntax error here. Amit corrected. The 5,000 is the right number. This is the old number. Subsequent slides show 5,000. It's not relevant, but we should be correct in everything that we do. So, about 5,000 students. And each student registers for an average of 6 courses. Let's say I'm teaching a course CS634, which is a course on information system. Assuming that there are at most 300 courses in a semester, print course list for all courses given all the registration forms of 4,500 students. The assumption is that each form has some fixed and some variable information. The fixed information is roll number, name, degree, branch, etc. And the variable information for each course is course code, name, credits, and slot. Okay. Assume all forms are stored in a file. So each form is a record, and there are 4,500 records in a file. Here is a simplified version of the form. In the form of, you are all familiar with file description entries in COBOL. So I think this should make sense to you. So there is a registration record. The fixed part of the registration record says it's a student roll number. We have character 8 and not digits, because we had to introduce A, D and such characters in the roll number. Say 8 character roll number. We have the name of the student, 50 characters. We had a problem here, we had a 40 character name, and then some young students from Andhra Pradesh complained that their full name cannot be written. So I don't know, currently it's about 100 characters or something, whatever. Why I mention this is, it's very, very important when you define the characteristics of an attribute, not only what you feel is right, but what is present in the real world should be reflected in the definition of your attributes. Then there is a degree that the student attends, which is BTech, MTech, MSc, PhD, MPhil, whatever. There is a branch, humanities, physics, chemistry, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering. We have three character course for these. There is a semester which is 1, 2 or 3 depending upon its autumn, spring or summer. And then there are number of courses that the student registers. The way we store this is, we have a variable which is registered number of courses, which could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And we are saying the, Amit, can you please note down? In the night, one is not very efficient and correct. This should be picture 99, and correspondingly the record size should be changed as 70 plus this. This is a fixed part. Anyway, so you are all familiar with arrays in COBOL. You could actually use an array which says range courses occurs 20 times depending upon range number of courses, etc., making it a variable type. But I am assuming that the COBOL compiler uses fixed length records, and therefore I am defining the array to be of size 20. However, as many courses as are registered are kept inside. The repetitive information is for each course that the student registers, the course code, the course name and the course grade. So this is one file. Now imagine a teacher like me who is teaching a course with you as students who are registered for it. For me, this information is useless. What I want is for my course, CS634, which are the roll numbers and names of the students who are attending that course. So consequently, I have a course list file, which is what I want to get, which has a course record, it has a course code, it has a course name, it has a course semester, it has a course number of students, meaning how many number of students are registered for that course. And then I have an array which is called course students, which occurs 600 times, because in IIT, the maximum number of students registered for a course could be very high. So we have, for example, an introductory programming course, which is currently taught in 2 batches, because there are just too many students, but they are all registered for CS101. Someday this number may increase to even 1000. And this brings us to another point. When I fix the, what happened to my cursor? Oh, it's here. When I fix this number 600, I am making a very important decision. If at any time in future, if this program has to register 601 students, that last student will have to be told, sorry, go play football, because there is no registration place in the disk for you. It's a completely unacceptable reasoning. But this is what happens when programmers make such choices without confirming the requirements. Worse, when they make such choices, it is not even known. So 3 years later, when 650 students are admitted to a course and the program doesn't run, the programmer on job at that point in time may not even know that the problem is appearing because of this funny restriction. And that's the importance of documentation of constraints, etc., etc., that we need to do. Anyway, I digress. So this is all very clear. Now our job is very simple. I have this. Let's go to the previous slide. I have this registration file. Let me just draw a record here. Let's say a fixed part where I have roll number, name, and the number of courses. Let's say 3 courses. And then I have course code, let's say CS101. And there is something which is a course name. So programming, whatever, credits 8. So this is the first element of the array, this is the second element of the array, and so on. Okay, let's say the next course is CS 6, 3, 4, and whatever, whatever. So I have such a file. Now, this is the surprise quiz. The surprise quiz is, from this file, get me this file. The file for a course list. So, this is the assignment. You understand this requirement? This requirement is completely different. This requirement says that you make another record for a course, let's say CS634, and then the course name, etc., etc. Assume the roll number here is 12345. Then I want 12345 to come here. Then next fellow may be 17289. So I want 17289 to come here, and so on. So if there are 300 students registered for my course, all those 300 out of 4,500 or 5,000 students, exactly those 300 students, I want to put them into this list. So given this file in COBOL, how will you get this file? That's the question. So here is a mechanism. Read the file one record at a time, this file. So you read this record. Now this record, you examine whether any one of the courses is CS634. You find it, you start constructing a record in memory, you put this roll number here. Go to the next record. If that fellow does not have any course registered, forget it. Go to the next, etc., etc., and carry on like this till you go to the end of file. By that time, you would have got all the students who have 634 as one of the courses, you would have assembled one record. Write it out. If somebody else wants a list for another course, do the same thing. How do you construct the list for all courses? So read the file one record at a time. If any of the courses matches CS634, print the roll number and name. So you can either print or assemble that. In a single scan of the file, the course list for CS634 is produced. However, the entire registration data for all students will have to be processed just to get one course list. If there are 300 courses, you'll have to read this file 300 times. And just to imagine, if 300 and such numbers are not very impressive, imagine a similar scenario where you have, let's say, all the policies that your customers have, 17 crore customers or whatever, 10 crore customers, and on an average 2 policies each, some have 5, some have 4, etc., etc. So you have this information, and along with the premium paid. And then you have another file you want to create for each policy, what are the premiums that have been paid. Now, so if you have 20 crore customers, you will scan that file 20 crore times for each policy. Mar gaya. Rest of the life, LIC will have to just do this. So obviously a bunkum algorithm. Anything better that you can suggest? So one is run the previous algorithm 300 times, once for each course. The file will be read 300 times. How costly is this operation? Since the file is on disk, you will have to read so many records from the disk. Assume each record is 1069 bytes, now 1070 bytes. You will make that correction, right? And there are 5000 students, not 4500. So there are roughly 5 million bytes. Now 5 million bytes, not a big deal. The memory that you have is no more limited to kilobytes. You have, in fact, gigabytes of memory. So you read the whole file in the memory, compile the list for all courses and put that back. But wait, consider the reverse problem also. Remember that at the end of the semester, when I grade the students, I will give each one of you a grade, A, A, B, B, C, whatever. Where will I fill it? In the course list. Now I'll submit this grade. So I will now give a course list back to the academic office, and it will have to compile grades for every individual student. So exactly reverse operation will have to be done. If I follow a similar algorithm there, then I will have to read the course file 5000 times this time for assembling the grades of every student. Okay. And then I will get this, the total file size, of course, is about 10 million, which is again not a big deal. But you cannot store all the records in the memory if you consider a real life situation where you have premium records and customer records, for example. Not possible. So any suggestion? How would you handle this? You have faced these problems? Some of you must have faced this problem. When you collect data, that standard inventory problem, a request from a workshop comes, they want 20 material to be issued. So there is a single list given, 20 items. The records maintained are part number wise inside the inventory. So you have to do this kind of transformation time and again. So what is the best way of doing that? Programmatically? So let's think for 2 minutes, because it's important that you think to figure out how you do that. This is rather fundamental in the development of the modeling that we are going to discuss later. So do think, how will you get this? From one file, sorry? Well, in any programming language, conventional programming language, where you are given these two file structures, any programming language, C, Java, whatever, it, actually the programming language is not important, but what algorithm will you use or what ingenuity will you apply to solve this problem? Please remember that the files available are, the first file can be sorted in roll number wise, but it does not give you a clue on which course it is, because the course is an array, you can't sort it on course code. The second file can be sorted on course code, but not on roll number, because individual roll number you can't, there's nothing like sorting algorithm sorts. When you have information on one column, then on that column you can make a sort. So sorting directly being applied to these two files doesn't solve your problem. How do you solve it? That's the question. So think. You must have faced this problem sometime or the other, or you are perhaps already given that this is the file and this is the information to be recorded, extracted. So what will you do? Will you apply the same scheme? Yeah.
I am Damodaran.
Yeah.
I have to restructure my FD means records in order to accommodate both.
Okay, so let's go back to that file. He is saying that I have to restructure my record. Unfortunately, restructuring is not feasible because it's the file that you have been given. So what you mean perhaps is create another file with some kind of restructuring.
Oh.
Okay, can you hold on for a second, because you seem to be getting the clue. So let's have some other ideas. Anybody else can think of? He has given you a clue. Somehow, and this came out of the obvious problem that I cannot sort either of the files in the way I desire to sort it. So unless I restructure it, I cannot apply sorting algorithm. And if I can't apply sorting algorithm, I can't solve this problem. Yeah.
I am Pramod Kumar. Actually, it is from what he told. What we would like to achieve here is some kind of relationship which we can build between the course list and the student.
Mm.
So for that, if we can create a structure where I have that relationship defined, so I can do both the forward and reverse mapping.
No, but you have been given these two file structures. So how will you restructure, or how will you create, what you are talking about is relationship between course and a student.
Okay, so
that is what we want to drive to. But from this given file, which is this file, registration file, what will you do to get that final file? That's what I want. So whatever way you restructure, after restructuring, you will have to re-restructure to get me that course file anyway. There is no shortcut to that, but how would you do that?
What we at, means in database, what we do is that...
No database. COBOL programming.
Okay. Because there we will
in fact, the reason for taking this very innocuous looking simple example is to illustrate that even in this very simple, straightforward problem which I'll face every day, life is not very easy. So let's go back to our friend, I forgot your name, Damodaran. So Damodaran will perhaps elaborate further on restructuring, and then we can take this forward.
Here we have to add one more field, which I could not able to see. second FD.
Add one more field. Which field?
I have to see FD of second.
Another file. So what will be the file description of that file?
I just want to see the FD of second one.
See the FD of second year. Here's the FD. Okay, there are two more people who want to answer. So just forward this mic, please. Yes.
In the previous FD, where the...
Please identify yourself.
I am Nilesh Soman.
Yes.
In the previous FD, we'll make some indexes. In the student's name, student's roll number will be the primary key, and the source code number of the course will be the alternate key.
I beg your pardon. It's a file. It's an array.
If it is a line sequential, we can index in sequential.
You can index on a field. Which field you will index? This is an array.
We will restructure the FD in that way.
How will you restructure? That's the question.
Making it a line sequential.
Yeah, the line sequential, but if it still continues to contain up to 20 courses that a student has registered, there's no way you can build any alternate or primary index on it. That's the whole point, that there are multi-valued attributes present here. A student is registering for multiple courses. If he was registering for only one course, life would have been easier. Yeah.
Actually, we can, from these two files, we can have a
third. No, we have only one file.
Yeah.
Huh.
It's two files,
no? No, the second file we have to create.
Okay.
The first file we have been given data. Students have come, all of you have come, you have filled up these registration forms. Okay, now these forms have gone and these forms have been captured in terms of this file.
Okay.
Now from this file, the academic information system that you are designing is to create a roll list for each teacher. So I am a teacher, I want all your names and roll number.
Okay, before creating that file, from this file we can create a small file which has only roll number and then course code and credit. This file, if we create, this can be used for both.
Actually, that is the right answer. I'm glad this answer emerged out of this group discussion, where he hinted at the relationship between two files, he hinted at restructuring, and finally found that out. So here is, this is a stupid method, this is worse, we have seen that it will not be possible to execute this algorithm. So first prepare a file of records in the following structure. I have said only roll number and course code, but I can add the credits, whatever course, you know, course name, course credits, everything I can. Please note, the important point is that wherever there were multi-valued features in the first file, namely a student had multiple courses, that has now been broken. So each form, each one record of that file will create on an average 6 records. If a student has registered for 3 courses, it will create 3 records, where the roll number will be same, but the course code will be different. One record for each course that student has registered. So if there are 5,000 students, and if on an average 6 courses are registered by those 5,000 students, there will be a total of 30,000 records in this file. Now you agree that I can sort this file on the course code field, because there is exactly one value in that column. When I sort it on the course code, and now start, I do one sort, and after that I start reading the sorted file. When I read the sorted file, I'll get, let's say, AE101, Aeronautical Engineering, first course. All the students who have registered for that course, their roll numbers will come in the sorted file. I assemble the second file's record from that. Whenever AE101 ends and AE102 starts, I will output that record onto the second file. Then I will start building AE102. In a single scan of such sorted file, I can construct the entire course list for all the courses. I can do exactly the reverse. I would like you to remember this point, that in order to break the jinx of multi-valued features in a form, trying to map that information into another multi-valued form of a different kind, the best way is to break that. And now I come back to the issue which Pramod Kumar had raised. He had hinted at the requirement of relationship between the two. Actually, if you see these two things, roll number represents what? A student. Course code represents what? A course. And a registration is nothing but a student saying, I want to relate to this course. So the association or relationship between course and student is being absolutely perfectly captured by this file. Actually, nothing else is important. The course name, the credits, etc. That's information relevant to a course. Student's name, hostel, etc. is information relevant to student. But the association is captured by just this. So if from a form, which has multi-valued things, I can create this, then I can get the other information. From the other, I can again create this and keep the first information. $1 million question is, then, why do I insist on storing information in this form, the registration, and in this form for the course list? This is a question which we shall answer when we shall see the entity relationship diagram or entity relationship model. But is this clear? Okay. There are some more aspects of conventional programming. I'll skip this slide because these are all well known to you. One is what we saw. You cannot carry out computations in memory, and you cannot carry out the computations in memory by reading all the data in files. That is obvious to all of you because you want to store the data in non-volatile form on disk. And you can assume that the entire files are too large to fit into the memory. Secondly, processing is normally done record by record in conventional programming language. You will not handle 2000 records, 20,000 records, 2 million records at a time. Wherever you need to do any aggregation or processing a set of records, you will have to specifically collect these records from the disk into an array internally, then do any summation, averaging, whatever you want to calculate and print out the result. So any aggregation or any operation on a set has to be explicitly done in conventional programming language by first collecting the set of that desired records from the disk, doing your processing and putting either that set back or what. This is an important distinction because conventional programming languages, whether it is C, COBOL, BASIC, Fortran, doesn't matter which one, typically will handle data in a record by record fashion. There is a fundamental paradigm shift that we are going to talk about when we look at the database management systems, and that is why it is important to know this distinction. The second, reading and writing to media such as this reads significantly more time than to memory. Nowadays, memory read-write cycles are of the order of tens of nanoseconds, whereas this, although they have improved significantly from old times, they are still Dutcher in terms of read-write speeds. You take a 3600 RPM there, okay, you cannot do more than 50 random IOs per second. You take twice that speed, 100 random IOs per second. You take three times that speed, four times that speed, you cannot still do more than 200 random IOs per second. In 1 second, you can read or write 200 blocks of disk randomly. Not in sequence. In sequence, you can read them fast. So that is very, very costly as compared to memory transactions. And that's the reason why all algorithms try to minimize the disk accesses. Now, here is a problem with conventional programming languages. Since your algorithm directly reads or writes to disk, the responsibility of making your algorithm efficient by reducing the number of disk accesses is entirely that of yours. You have no help in that. You write a bad algorithm and the algorithm will spend its lifetime in reading and writing to disk. You design a good algorithm, it will save some time. So consequently, every programmer has to be perpetually worried about minimizing disk access. And we will all be very glad if someone else takes this responsibility. We write our processing algorithm and let somebody figure out how to do it in minimum disk access. Right. So that's another problem with the conventional programming model for building business information. We now therefore lead to the discussion on databases by starting to look at the need for system modeling. Once we identify the functional requirements of a system, we need to know more details about what information is required, how it is represented, what are the user interfaces to the information system, what are the specifications for processing logic, and finally, what is the control of processing sequence? All of these, by the way, form part of another important subject matter called software engineering. So that's not part of this course, but those of you who are interested should read a beautiful book by Pressman. It is called Software Engineering, A Practitioner's Approach. SEPA is a very, very favorite book of most professionals, and you should like this database book by Karl Silverscharz and Sudarshan is considered Bible in database activity in the world. SEPA is another Bible. All of you should have that book. Maybe next time we have a course, although we'll have some Java books there, but that book we should all have. So these are general software engineering concepts, but what we are going to discuss today, leading to database management systems, is just the modeling of information. The information modeling needs to capture the information structure, which means what are the entities about whom we want to capture the information and what is that information. Then we want to capture the functional behavior. How do things change? How does the cumulative performance index of a student change? So what is the computational logic? You take all the grades, multiply them by grade points, do something, etc., etc. How does the data flow? First a student registers, then he attends courses, gives exams, gets grades, then all the grades are combined. One semester is over, next semester the student does the same thing, does it consecutively for 8 semesters, then gets a BTEC degree. So this is the workflow. Control behavior, events and action. Okay, if a student fails in a course, that student has to repeat the course. If a student has already got a BB grade in a course, he cannot register in that course again to get an AA grade. There are some of the rules which the Institute Senate will make, exactly similar to the rules that you make for your premium collection, for policy issues, for different types, etc. So these are the control behaviors, functional behavior and information structure that needs to be captured. As I said, these are all parts of the software engineering kind of syndrome, but what we are going to discuss here is the entity and its attributes represented as the fundamental model of the information system that you are considering. First of all, entity is any object or thing which is relevant to our needs. The example is an inventory system, a part, a supplier, a plant, a transaction. These are all entities. Student, teacher, course, department, hostel, these are all entities. A important point to note is that when we speak of entities in an academic context, for example, that we looked at, it does occur to us to consider student as an entity. It does occur to us to consider teacher as an entity. But it does not naturally occur to us to consider a registration form as an entity or a course list as an entity. We automatically regard these as some kind of byproducts of the information system. Even though the form is crucial because the form originates the collection of information, but we are collecting information about a student and the courses that the student takes. So the entities, as far as we are concerned, we can clearly see that student and teacher and course and department are the entity. Okay. This is a very important point in modeling. When human beings model entities, they are intuitively able to identify main entities very clearly. Once you identify entities which are relevant to your business, then you say that these entities together form an entity set. In object-oriented paradigm, this is called an object class. All entities of a similar type make an entity set. So all students in IIT Bombay will be a student entity set. All courses offered in IIT Bombay will be a course entity set. All teachers of IIT Bombay will be a teacher entity set, and so on. So like for you, policy could be an entity. So all policies entity set, customer is an entity, branch is an entity, all branches form an entity set. That could be a very natural way of modeling things. Entity set naturally consists of entities of the same type, goes without saying. Why? What do we mean by same type? When we say entities are of the same type, what we mean is each of those entities of a set have exactly the same set of attributes to describe those entities. So characteristic features of any entity in a set which play a role in business function. We saw, for example, for a student, the roll number, name, okay, maybe hostel of residence, maybe cumulative performance index, hobbies, courses registered for. These are all attributes of a student. Height, weight is an attribute, birth date is an attribute. married or unmarried is an attribute. But is it relevant for my academic business? Perhaps not. So while an entity may have thousands of attributes that we can think of, and we must think of thousands, we then eliminate all those unwanted attributes which have no relevance to our business needs and retain only those which are relevant to business. There is one caveat though, that the business needs should not be defined wrongly for a short duration for solving a small problem that you have at hand. Business needs should be defined for a 10-year, 15-year duration. So many times we forget to identify a particular attribute of an entity. And guess what happens? Next time, you have to add a field to your COBOL FD because somebody did not think of that field. Or if I do not characterize each attribute properly, such as picture X40, then sometime later you'll have to make it into picture 104, X140 or whatever. So these decisions are very crucial and they must be correctly made at the earliest time. That's the importance of proper model. Given the entities and attributes, we would like to represent them. One representation is of course textual. You give an entity name and you list all the attributes giving the characteristic. The other is a pictorial attribute, which is what gives the name called ER model, which we shall see in a moment. Here are some examples of attributes. For example, for an inventory part, these could be the attributes. So can you make some sense out of these attributes which are listed here? P number, part number, part name, part location, because in an inventory of 10,000 racks, so which rack, which bin, your part number. P quantity, what is the part quantity available? What is PROP and PROQ?
Request order quantity.
This is reorder point. That means if the quantity of the item goes below that, say 50, then you have to reorder so that by the time these 50 are exhausted, the other material has come. PROQ is reorder quantity. At any point, how much should I reorder? 300, 500. These are decided by the inventory management algorithm. Why I spend so much time on the terms like PROP, PROQ, etc.? If you are a COBOL programmer, not in LIC, but in an inventory manufacturing system doing inventory, you are likely to use in your programs variable names such as PROP, PROQ, because you and your colleagues understand them immediately. Rest of the world does not understand them at all. Now you go back to all the file descriptions that you have seen in your COBOL programs. Can you not remember some names of those fields which only you can understand and rest of the world cannot? Please remember, the rest of the world also includes a few young aspirants who will join LIC 2 years later. And instead of going through the hustle bustle of branch activity where they will learn all this terminology, they may directly be posted in the IT department. The poor fellow has learned databases, Java, etc., etc., but he does not understand that prem means premium. And then he will be given a task by Seema or Rose saying, please maintain this system because it modification is required tomorrow in some branch. These are some very, very fundamental disciplines that as developers you must inculcate. Every institution which does software development has large manuals, coding standards, programming standards, documentation standards. You would have some, but you'll have to build a lot more. You would have heard of CMM level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5. We are already at level 1, for example, IIT Bombay. You know what level 1 means? Level 1 means all processes are ad hoc, and if there is success, it is incidental. That's called level 1 CMM. Level 5 is what we all need to achieve. So although I'm digressing from the database, but it's a very, very important aspect of life. Anyway, let's go further. So for student entity, for example, we could identify roll number, name, hostel of residence, room number, performance index, courses registered, hobbies, etc. as, let's say, important. In order to depict them, we use this entity relationship model or ER model. It's a very old classical model of representing information which permits us to display information that we need to handle for our business purpose. So we represent all entities and all their attributes. the entity set is represented by a rectangle and attribute is represented by an ellipse. So here is the entity model for a student. So the rectangle here shows student entity, means it represents the student entity set. Each of the 5000 students will have exactly same attributes. So it has an attribute, roll number, name, hostel, room, CPI, courses, hobbies. A few peculiarities: every name is preceded by S. This is my way of showing in this small diagram that there has to be a characteristic name for every attribute. For example, there will be a course name also. If I say name here and name there, then they will be confused. So I should actually say student name, there I should say course name. COBOL programs permit variables of how many characters? What is the LIC rule for the minimum length of a variable? 8, not good enough, because then you will compress or make an acronym sometimes. In TCS, I believe it is 20 or 24 characters. But TCS takes that thing very strictly. They don't do much COBOL programming anymore. But those days when they did, and if anybody used a 15 character variable name, he would lose his job simply. That's the strictness with which the discipline is followed. No questions asked.